Well, good evening. Thank you very, very much. I do want to clearly express a word of thanks to Stan Hamm and our hosts here at Providence Seminary. We really have been warmly received here, but also to the good people at CMU who were part of the planning, and now to you for making time in your day for coming out for this conversation. I'm just curious, this is the fourth of three events in 2 days. How many of you are maybe here for the first time? So a few. Okay. I ask that because you know, when you are compressing material into four presentations, it's hard to get to what you want to talk about without giving a context. And some of you who have already been to a presentation will have heard some of this context before. And so I apologize if some of this sounds familiar or like I've seen that slide before. I was reminded there was a story that a Mennonite bishop in Indiana used to say that he was invited to preach somewhere on Sunday morning, and he preached a sermon, and then he had an afternoon session, and he was pained when he noticed in the audience somebody who was present at the first gathering because he hadn't prepared a second sermon, and so he preached the same sermon in the afternoon, and he had an evening event, and lo and behold, this same person showed up at the evening, which really put his plan into arrears. And at the end, as they were leaving and shaking hands, he saw this man and he said, "I am so sorry. I know you were there in the morning and the afternoon, now in the evening again, and I preached the same sermon." And the man said, "Oh, I hadn't noticed." So I suspect some of you will notice, but I thank you for your understanding. Let's see if we can get this. You don't seem to have. Maybe it works manually. No? Well, I may need a little bit of help right off the bat with. What have we done wrong? We got this far. Maybe that doesn't. I'll just do it from here.
I don't think it works. Does anybody know anything about this? I don't think that's a touch.
Oh. Oh, that's what we...
There you go. And then just use the arrow keys.
Use the arrow keys down here. Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
That's what we needed. Christians sometimes tell their testimony as a conversion story. I once was lost and now I'm found. My life has had many conversions. Including a classic conversion. I was just reminded of that this afternoon. We were talking about revival meetings, and George R. Brunk II was the revival preacher at the first time that I was converted. But there have been other times when I have been prompted to rethink where I am going, to reevaluate, and to reorient how I think of myself and how I make sense of the world. In one of my favorite books, a book by Catherine Schultz called Being Wrong, Adventures in the Margin of Error, Schultz talks about going on an extended road trip with a friend. And at some point toward the end of her journey, she asked her friend why the highway department would use Chinese characters in their road signs. And her friend was very baffled until they came to one of those signs, which, of course, actually signals a picnic area. Some version of this has happened to all of us, I think, often in ways in which much more was at stake than misreading a sign. The world makes sense to us in one way, and then suddenly something happens that forces us to reevaluate what we thought we knew, and then we begin, often slowly, but we begin to see the world in a fresh perspective. This evening, I'd like to share a bit from my experience as a historian, committed to the vocation of doing scholarship in and for the church, and some of the, or at least one of the conversions that I've experienced along the way. And it's a story, as I've mentioned in other settings, it's a story that is ongoing. And so I'm excited to both share my testimony, but I'm also eager to hear from others. As historians do, I guess, I need to begin with a bit of context. Considered from the grand perspective of a 500-year-old history, Mennonites in North America find themselves, I think, in an intriguing and paradoxical moment in time. On the one hand, things have never been better for the Anabaptist Mennonite tradition, at least in terms of a certain status within the broader family of Christian denominations. For more than four centuries, most Christians in positions of authority regarded the Anabaptist Mennonites with a certain amount of disdain if they took note at all. The Anabaptists, beginning in the 16th century, were seditious revolutionaries. They were Schwärmer, as Luther called them, Rottengeister, which is not a kind term. They embodied the worst excesses of religious reform in the 16th century. They were, in the words of a standard German church history textbook, the deformation of the Reformation. Less polemical writers described us as sectarians, as maybe an interesting sideline in church history, but of little consequence to the larger themes of Western society, where the real heavy lifting in terms of political ethics was done by Catholics and by mainline Protestants who accepted responsibility for the maintenance of public culture. But then during the course of the 20th century, for reasons that are too complex to go into here, that negative assessment began to shift. First among historians of the Reformation, who began to slowly recognize the Anabaptist movement and the radical Reformation as a legitimate expression of the Christian faith, and to slowly bring that tradition into conversation with the larger streams of church history. Later, not long after, that theme was taken up by a number of influential theologians who recognized in some way that today all churches, Catholic, Protestant, and Anabaptist alike, are disestablished in the sense that all of us function as free churches or voluntary churches. You can baptize infants into a Catholic church or into a Lutheran or Anglican church. You can baptize them as infants, but there is no guarantee that the structures of society around them are going to nurture the child into a faith that is somehow self-evident or obvious, so that every group faces the challenge of inviting their children into an adult decision of commitment to the church. Today, at a time when public Christianity seems to be filled with hypocrisy, many Christians are attracted to the strong emphasis in our tradition on a life of practical discipleship, a commitment to service, of walking alongside the weak and the marginalized. For many, the Mennonite emphasis on community is an attractive antidote to the individualism of Western culture. And above all, amid the divisiveness of our culture, my culture, I'll say, in the United States, and the violence of our world, the Anabaptist Mennonite witness to the gospel of peace and reconciliation has found a hearing. If not complete affirmation, at least it has found a respectful hearing. And in some circles today, this tradition that was once reviled by the broader Christian community has become almost chic, a sort of darling child. The distinctive theological concerns of the Anabaptist Mennonite tradition have entered into the mainstream of American religious discourse and enjoy broad visibility in publishing houses like Erdmann's Press, or Brazos, or Baker, or InterVarsity Press, and in many, though not all, in many seminaries. Doors that were once firmly closed have been open, and we at least clearly have a seat at the table as respected conversation partners. But all of this, of course, is only a part of the story. Behind every silver lining is a dark cloud. As a historian, I find it profoundly ironic that just at the moment when the Anabaptist Mennonite tradition seems to have gained a hearing in the public arena, we find ourselves, and here again I speak, I know my context is not the same as yours, but I'll speak on my perspective, Mennonite Church USA, we find ourselves in a state of precarious health that may be verging on a crisis. A merger in 2001 that was going to strengthen our mission and renew our identity had the unintended consequence of nationalizing our churches. So now we have Mennonite Church USA and Mennonite Church Canada, leaving us more fragmented than ever before. Only 10 years after that merger, even before our largest district conference, the Lancaster Conference, left, overall membership in this merged MC church had declined by 15%. The average age of our membership is rapidly increasing. Today, the average age of membership in MCUSA is 59. In a survey 10 years ago, less than a third of our members claimed to have a strong commitment to the denomination. Although 90% believe that Christians should do all they can to convert non-believers to Christ, 90% believe that, only 18% do so on a regular basis. And more than a third of our members agree with the statement that church denominations do not matter. And the litany of concerns doesn't end with those statistics. Over the past two decades, virtually all of our churchwide agencies have struggled to maintain funding for their programs. I teach at a Mennonite college where we have watched the percentage of our students coming to us from Mennonite churches steadily decrease. Increasingly, our denominational programs find themselves in direct competition with other local initiatives. There are 95 full-time fundraisers in the Mennonite Church in the United States, representing everything from church camps to programs for the disabled to Mennonite elementary and Mennonite high schools, all of which are hiring staff and fundraisers and graphic artists and newsletter editors to generate support for their cause. And parachurch initiatives are promising their own versions of congregational renewal that with a kind of appeal and attractiveness and a professionalism that completely outguns the denominational efforts. Overlaid on all of this is a professed desire to be mission-oriented. Missional has been a very strong word in our circles in the past decade. And I would say that most congregations in, say, the heartland churches have a very keen awareness that for too long their cultural and genealogical and ethnic markers that form them as a community have been a barrier to newcomers who are seeking fellowship and these congregations. For too long, we've been cultural and ethnic enclaves turned in on ourselves. And now, in a response, a genuine desire, I think, to be missional, the immediate impulse is to jettison anything associated with a distinctly Mennonite identity. As a result, the public face of many congregations is increasingly characterized by a kind of generic Christianity that can be summarized as believe in the Bible as the Word of God, accept Jesus Christ into your heart as Lord and Savior, and then allow whatever to emerge in a local context to emerge, but distinctive Mennonite teachings and practices will need to be downplayed or suppressed if we truly want to be welcoming to people in our community. Ironically, just at the moment when the distinctive theological emphases of the Anabaptist Mennonite tradition are being embraced in ecumenical circles and in the public arenas of historical and theological conversations, Mennonites in my setting are eager to put as much distance as possible from the distinctives of their identity and are being increasingly pulled into the divisive political debates of the national culture that are too often framed in the exact language of that divisive culture rather than the distinctive language of a theological tradition. I know your context far less well, but I do read the Canadian Mennonite, I read the MB Herald, I read the Messenger, I read the Chronicle, and I would say by virtually all standards or measurements of health, it's a generalization, but the Mennonite Church in North America is facing some significant challenges. And yet, see, I keep moving. Even as we are struggling to untangle a sense of the future, even as we are trying to imagine, so what does the future look like? The broader Anabaptist Mennonite Fellowship has been quietly in the midst of a period of extended and explosive growth. Today, we are living in the midst of what can only be called a revolutionary moment in the history of our 500-year-old tradition. In 1978, this will look familiar to some of you. In 1978, there were 600 and some thousand Anabaptist Mennonites in the world, almost all of them, or at least the great majority, in North America and Europe. So in the blue line there, you see our numbers in 1978. Between 1978 and 2015, we have actually a few more recent data from 2018, but in 2015, those numbers grew almost threefold, so that today there are 2.2 million Anabaptist Mennonites in the world instead of 600,000 when I started teaching. And again, when you think about this as a 500-year-old tradition, we are living in our lifetimes, we are living in the midst of a dramatic event in the history of our tradition, of this rapid growth. And the growth, as these charts suggest, is happening almost entirely outside of North America and Europe. So that today, if we look at Mennonite World Conference churches, not all Anabaptists and Mennonites are part of Mennonite World Conference. So the Old Order Amish, for example, Old Colony Mennonites. We haven't, the Hutterites are not yet. Maybe we can work at that. But so there are significant groups that are not yet, or not, I shouldn't say yet, who are not part of Mennonite World Conference. But of those who are, you've heard Gerald already mention, 10,000 congregations, a full half are in the continent of Africa, another quarter in Asia, And I think the 7% is a little bit low in Latin America. With North America and Europe coming along behind. I've said this before, I'll say it again. Since 2000, 93% of the growth in our global Anabaptist Mennonite family has come in churches in Africa, Asia, and Latin America. In 2002, the Meseret de Christos Church of Ethiopia surpassed Mennonites in the United States to become the largest group. Today, some 375,000 baptized members, but we know that on any given Sunday morning, there are many, many more than that who are part of their worship services. The reasons for this globalization I detailed last night. I won't go into detail this evening again, but if you're here for the first time, I will just review and say that part of the globalization has come by the migration and the ongoing migration, this is not just a historical reality, of German-speaking ethnic Mennonites. So think primarily old colony Mennonites, Rhinelander, Bergtaler, Cortiza, Sommerfelder, who in Mexico, Belize, Bolivia, where else? Paraguay, Brazil, and now increasingly, as the land hunger drives into Peru, Chile, and I've just learned many are also returning to Manitoba in search of land. A second reason for the globalization, it won't surprise you, is the mission movement of the 20th century. So in keeping with the broader Protestant mission initiative, Mennonites were a little slow, but Mennonites planted more than 100 different missionary starts in countries all around the world, the various groups of Anabaptist Mennonite missions. And in many places, those mission initiatives have thrived. A third, much smaller, but worth mentioning, is the growth of what might be called neo-Anabaptist networks. These are people in various places around the world who are attracted to the ideas of Anabaptism, who find the Anabaptist message to resonate, and yet are not quite ready to leave their own denominations, but have found themselves in conversation with each other. And so there are a kind of independent movements of networks, and they claim the Anabaptist name, even if they don't show up in MWC statistics. And this is a kind of global movement with a significant numbers in China, for example. Numerically not strong, not overwhelming, but symbolically it's very interesting to me, and I think we want to keep an eye on it. I spent last night a fair amount of time making the argument that the real reason for the dramatic growth in the global church is that at a certain point when the missionaries turned the missions over to the recipients of the Gospels in many different cultural contexts, at that moment, it was often a precarious handoff, but at a certain moment when the local leadership owned the message of the gospel and begin to translate it into their hymns, their sermons, their confessions of faith, the styles, the idioms, the culturally appropriate forms, this is where we see the most dramatic growth. And often lay missionaries. It's not professional missionaries. It's often, frankly, it's often women who begin traveling, walking, talking, sharing, friendship evangelism, and an enthusiasm and excitement about the gospel. So that today there are very large churches, Mennonite-identified churches in the Democratic Republic of Congo, Brethren in Christ churches in Zimbabwe, very large church. Daryl Klemenhage has been, his family life story is connected with the church in Zimbabwe. I think 8 groups in India, including strong Mennonite Brethren presence in Shamshabad with the Centenary Mennonite Bible College there. but also in Damtri and in other places in India. In Indonesia, three thriving groups, the most recent being a charismatic group that is the group that has the holy stadium where the Mennonite World Conference will be meeting. Remarkable combination of vigorous missionizing in an intensely Muslim context that has been brought together with social outreach. So they serve thousands of meals every day. They have a soccer league. They have a support for young families, for single women. It's a remarkable blend of charismatic worship and intense social commitment to the human needs of the community that they're part of. But that's only one of the three groups in Indonesia and in many, many other countries as well. And you know some of these from your own settings. So that the map of the Global Anabaptist Fellowship today looks something like this, with the strongest concentration, as you can see visually, in the continent of Africa. 227 total groups, 80 countries, 2.2 million. The challenge, as I suggested again last night, is how do we nurture a shared sense of identity in this global context? And what will be what's the basis for thinking about unity? The Apostle Paul uses the image of the body. It's a beautiful image in which the body is incomplete if it assumes that any one part can exist independently of the other. And we sometimes focus on the visible organs of the body, but holding those visible organs together is a skeleton, and keeping them in communication is a nervous system and a blood supply system and complex systems that are often operating in ways that aren't so visible but are keeping the body alive. Last night, I spent some time suggesting another image for the global church. Again, metaphors always have limits, but I used a botanical image of the rhizome plant, which propagates by spreading roots, a network of roots beneath the surface, and pops up in surprising ways, unpredictable ways, and yet what looks like distinct plants above the ground is actually an interconnected network. It's one body beneath the soil. And I particularly like this because it's an image of the church that is not hierarchical. It's an image of a church that says, no, we're connected in many quiet ways, often that go unseen. I had an extended conversation with Royden Lowen tonight, who's chair of Mennonite studies at University of Winnipeg, and has been working also on global projects, as have I, and we discovered at various points that our interests have overlapped, and we know the same people, and we're connected, and we shared some other contacts with each other. That, to me, in a very small, modest way, is an example of how rhizomic connections happen, and we feel connected because we have personal face-to-face context. I think in the Anabaptist Mennonite tradition, relationships are at the heart of how we think about church. And even though it's untidy, it's cumbersome, it's not easily controlled, it's not program-driven, these many-faceted relationships are real and they matter. And I suggested that Mennonite World Conference exists to nurture rhizomic relationships. That is in some ways a summary of what I've shared in other settings. It's important to me to position this, what I've just described, in a broader context, because what I see as a revolution in the Anabaptist Mennonite tradition is actually only a very small part of a much larger phenomenon that has been happening in Christianity itself. What historians like Philip Jenkins and Lamansana and many others have described as global Christianity, in which the demographic center of the entire Christian church, not just the Anabaptist Mennonite church, the demographic center has shifted from Europe and North America to Africa, Asia, and Latin America. One of the important points that the historians of global Christianity have reminded us of, that I want to put before us again tonight, is just to reorient our perspective a little bit and to remember that Christianity from the beginning has been a non-Western and a global phenomenon. Now, we are used to thinking in terms of the form of Christianity that emerged in Catholicism, the Latin Catholic Church, which, if you recall, is only one of five of the apostolic seats of the early church. And in 1054, the Eastern Orthodox Church formally broke with the Latin West, and they have gone on to think of themselves as the true inheritors of the Christian tradition. The Antiochian Orthodox understand themselves to be heirs of the true Christian tradition. The Greek Orthodox in Constantinople understand themselves to be heirs. So when we think of Christianity and tell our story, we tell it through the lens of one of the five apostolic seats, that is the seat in Rome, which gave rise to the Western or Latin Catholic Church, which then at the Protestant Reformation gave birth to the many denominations and groups that we identify today as central to our understanding of the Christian faith in Europe and in North America. And indeed they are, but we should not forget that, in fact, the majority of the Christian church has found its home outside of the West. And so what global Christianity is actually nothing new. The church has always been non-Western. What is new is the rapid growth. And there are many ways, I won't bore you with a lot of statistics, but I find this chart to be particularly relevant, so that the yellow bar here, which you can easily see, 1900, this is a percent, as a percent of the global church, Europe and North America. The green is Latin America, red is Asia, and the purple is Africa. And what you can see in just steady increments is the diminishing presence of the West in relationship to the other groups. If you adjust for the growth in global population, so you could say, well, the world's getting, there are more people in the world, so of course there would be more Christians. And here are the rates of growth beyond birth rates in South America, Asia, and Africa. And it turns out that Europe and North America are losing ground in terms of birth rates. Today, doesn't come as a surprise, this is true of the Mennonite World Conference as well. Today, the typical Christian is a young woman from the village in the Congo. And I would say that's probably the case for us. It might be, when I say the village is the part that I'm not sure of, because there are a lot of young people who are moving to the city. But here you can see percent in the various countries who are under 15 years old. That's really a phenomenal, or I think it's a really significant thing to pay attention to. We are aging societies, and Africa, Asia, Latin America are much, much younger, and Africa above all. In the midst of this phenomenon is, we have to name the significance of Pentecostalism. It is not the only driving factor. But it is a powerful force in the global church. And the moment we talk about the church outside of Europe and North America, we need to be attentive to Pentecostalism. By some estimates, 1 in 12 persons in the world today is Pentecostal. And here you can see the rise in numbers from the origins. I mean, Pentecost began in Pentecost, but in the denominational sense or in the church historical sense, it began with the Azusa Street revivals early in the 20th century and has gone on now to become a major expression. Latin America especially, 49% of Christians in Brazil identify as Pentecostal, 30% in Chile, 60% in Guatemala of Christians are comfortable with that. Here's another way of describing that, in which the darkest red are the highest percentage. So 22 to 33% in those regions. Those are just a kind of visual image. Of the 2.4 billion Christians in the world, I think it's worth noting that about 1.2 billion are Catholics. And that number continues to grow. The Catholic Church continues to grow in many parts of the world. About 300 million are Orthodox. The African independent churches, which are growing almost as quickly as Pentecostals, at 84 million. African independent churches or African initiated churches are churches that bear resemblance to Christianity, but often claim some legacy, some identity with the Christian faith, but often are gathered around the charismatic presence of a prophet, somebody who has had a vision and maybe a new revelation. And it makes missiologists uncomfortable to know how do we categorize AIC churches. Are they really Christians? Well, they are deeply indigenized expressions of faith and have embraced their culture sometimes as an explicit rejection of Western forms of Christianity and said, we need to define for ourselves what this means. 84 million. Pentecostal, 600 million. And keep in mind here, this is a statistic that I think is worth noting. You know, last few years, we have celebrated, and rightly so, the 500th anniversary of the Protestant Reformation. And if you happen to be in Germany, you will know that the German government spent close to €1 billion in projects, a 10-year-long project, the Luther Decade, the Luther Decade, celebrating Martin Luther and the emergence of the Protestant Reformation. And the culmination of these events was in 2017, 500 years after Luther nailed his 95 theses to the church door at Wittenberg. And you would think that this was the hinge upon which all of Christian history turned. And again, it's not wrong. I welcome Luther into the pantheon of Christian heroes. I have no problem saying he was influential, despite what he said about the Anabaptists. We borrowed much from Luther. We can claim him. And yet, let's put this in perspective. Today, in the full scope of global Christianity, the groups that are growing the fastest, and that would be Pentecostals and AICs, live in a theological world that has very little interest in the theological arguments that Luther and the Reformers regarded as essential to the Christian faith. Debates over the nature of the sacraments, debates over the freedom of the will that we think, well, of course, I mean, how could you not read Scripture and come to the awareness that you've got to get this right in Scripture, the freedom of the will? Or are you an Arminian? Are you a predestined? AICs and Pentecostals are not that interested in those debates. They don't see them as at the heart of what their concerns are. And it is a reflection back to us that there are, and certainly the Catholics and the Orthodox don't regard those issues as the central concerns of their theological identity. It's not to dismiss the product. I spent a good bit of my life studying the 16th century, and I care about those theological debates. I think in some contexts they're very important, and I want to engage them. So I'm not saying they're unimportant, but we should put ourselves in perspective. And what part of what this means is that we are not at the center around which everything else revolves in the way that we sometimes picture ourselves, or I should personalize it, in the way that I picture myself. Mennonite Church USA and Mennonite Church Canada combined are less than 7% of our global Anabaptist fellowship. And that's not how we see it. We see ourselves as thought leaders. We see ourselves as movers and shakers, as people who are framing the agenda for the global church, or for whatever. But we need to step back and remind ourselves, where do we fit? So what about the future of the Anabaptist Mennonite tradition? That none of this will surprise you, and I won't linger on it. But I'm not a prognosticator, but I think we should assume that there will be ongoing demographic decline in traditional Mennonite churches in Europe and North America. Part of that has to do with family size. Part of that has to do with the fact that I mentioned that 90% of my folks think we should share the gospel with everyone we meet, and only 18% do. Part of it is the legacy of an identity whose boundaries are not very porous, that don't make it easy for newcomers to find themselves at home in our midst. And part of it is the secularization of our culture. All four of my daughters were baptized into the church. All of them, I think, would say they are Christians. Only two go to church. And one of them goes to an Episcopalian church, which I'm okay with. But, you know, I would be happier if all four went to Mennonite churches. I mean, that's how we raised them, isn't it? I lament that, but I don't think it's not an unusual family story in my circles. I think that we will see ongoing growth of Old Colony Mennonites and Old Order Amish, and I assume Hutterites. I haven't followed that story as closely, but if the trajectory continues as it has in the past, your numbers will continue to grow. And I know there is an impulse here in all three of those groups. I don't have the Hutterites up there, but I should. There's a kind of quick response that says, oh yeah, but it's just your own kids. And I am not nearly as quick to say that as I used to. Certainly not, it's just your own kids. Because I think our first mission field is to those people closest to us. And if the good news of the gospel is not attractive and compelling to our own children, it's a little presumptuous to think we have something to say to people in some other part of the world. So I think the fact that the Amish retain in LaGrange County, where I'm from, the Amish retain 92% of their children. I don't know what it is in other Amish communities, but that's a remarkable fact and shouldn't be dismissed too casually. There are choices being made to remain Amish, and I assume the same is true in Old Colony and Hutterite groups as well. By the way, the Amish, the group I know best, has doubled in size every 20 years in the course of the 20th century, and they are on track to do so again, so that there would be, I think in 2030, 250,000 Amish, in 2050, 500,000 Amish. 2070, a million? Who knows how the trajectories go, but that's part of the story. ongoing growth of what we have called, I don't really like this term, but we call it racial ethnic churches in North America, and what some global historians call reverse missions. I think whatever you call it, you recognize the phenomenon of immigrant groups coming to Canada. I think of Vancouver, of Edmonton, I assume Winnipeg, where else? Abbotsford, those areas. Immigrant groups coming, and Philadelphia, Los Angeles in the United States, New York City, and they're coming out of a wide variety of contexts, but they're coming as excited, committed Christians, and they're bringing the fervency and the assumptions of their faith and their worldview with them when they come, and they're establishing churches that are, generally speaking, growing and thriving. So that, and that's not just among Mennonites, but that's also among many other Christian groups, including groups like the Coptic Church, or the Redeemer Church from Nigeria, that is an AIC, African-initiated church that has expanding all around the world. And I think this phenomenon is also going to continue, and it's worth bearing witness to. It's worth being attentive to with a certain amount of humility, not just as an exotic ethnic coloring in our otherwise sort of familiar landscapes, but what's happening in those churches? And is there something happening that we can learn from? And finally, again, not surprising, I think there will be ongoing growth and ongoing cultural diversity in the global Anabaptist Mennonite church. So what does that diversity look like? In 2015, we started, actually it started even earlier, 2013, we tried to get some sense of that diversity with the Institute for the Study of Global Anabaptism. We started at 7, didn't we? I'm gonna stop very soon. Sorry, I'm just realizing what time it is. Have trouble with that.
Don't worry about it.
Well, I will worry a little bit though. We have these big numbers, but we don't have a very granulated sense. We don't have a very closer understanding of, well, what is it that groups believe? What are their practices? What are their customs? How do they think about baptism? How do they think about a whole host of things? What are they experiencing? And so this was an effort. We invited, first we had a selection. It's a proportionate to our regions, a random selection. So it was attempted to be social scientifically somewhat careful. And then we invited representatives appointed by church leaders to gather and to create a survey. So they shaped the survey based on the shared convictions of Mennonite World Conference. 18 or 24 member groups, 18 countries. We were looking at demographic information and beliefs and practices translated into 26 languages. And when it was done, we had leaders come together again. And by the way, Ron Penner and his daughter, whose name I'm forgetting,
Robin,
were the research associates from the EMC Church that participated in this profile. The results of which are here, the distillation of the results, which are published, and that's also available in Spanish and French. So what did we learn? Just very quickly. First, interesting, and I'm going to go through this more faster than you can keep up with, but I'm glad to share them if you're interested. We asked groups, how do you identify yourself? And they could use more than one term, so that's why they don't all add up to 100. But interestingly, a fair number were happy to call themselves Anabaptist. Relatively few, that surprised me, identified themselves as Pentecostal or Charismatic, even though their worship services would be described as that. A significant number have Mennonite, and some as Evangelical. Interesting, the highest is in Latin America, and the next highest with Evangelical is North America. The challenges and priorities that we face. Well, in growing churches, if you're planting churches, it means that those new churches need leadership. And if you're young churches, as most of the groups in the Global South are. It means that theological education is a crucial question. And we've spent a lot of conversation. ICOM has done really, this is the international body of Mennonite Brethren, have worked really hard at addressing the challenge of theological education. But in general, our seminaries in the North are under-enrolled. We have more resources than students. And in the South, there is a desperate hunger for seminary or for theological education. And it's education that needs to be affordable, accessible, and appropriate. So this is my mantra every time I talk about theological education. It's not a matter of just translating whatever curriculum we're doing at Associated or Anabaptist Mennonite Biblical Seminary or at CMU, translating that curriculum into Amharic and dropping and saying, okay, here you go, or using our accreditation standards as if it makes sense in their settings. If you're working with people who have rudimentary, if are struggling to send their children to have basic literacy, and their pastors are at a 10th or 12th grade education, it means that it has to be appropriate to whatever their level of education is and the cultural context. So ideally, the curriculum would emerge out of their own context. Experiences of persecution. I shouldn't have been surprised by this, but it still was sobering. A significant number of brothers and sisters in the Global South, particularly in various countries in Africa, say that they often experience persecution. Now, it doesn't necessarily mean that they are being martyred, but there is some cost for discipleship, some cost for following Jesus in daily life that is felt. And we have worked in the Institute for the Study of Global Anabaptism to gather those stories. So the Bearing Witness Stories Project, I sometimes describe it as the next volume of the Martyr's Mirror, in that we want to gather consciously stories of people that have names and that have contexts of how, in what way has it been costly for you to follow Jesus? You know, the Church of the Brethren, the EYN Church in northeastern Nigeria, has gone through an enormously painful period of their history, suffering the attacks, in this case, from a radical group called Boko Haram. So that in 2016, in April, the 273 schoolgirls who were kidnapped in Chibok, most of those young girls were part of that EYN, the Church of the Brethren, in Nigeria. And in that last, 6 years, they have identified 10,000 people in their group who have been killed, which is three times more than exist in the Martyr's Mirror. That's in our memory, in our lifetime. And it seems to me that if we are connected, even if only distantly, we should take notice of that. We should bear witness. We should be attentive and listen to those stories. What does the future look like for our global church? Well, the challenge of responding to Muslim neighbors. And here, you've already heard me describe one end of that spectrum. And it's real. I am not someone who would say, yeah, but I know all of the dangers of stereotyping. And I would hate it if other people in the world judge Christianity on the basis of the Westboro Baptist group in Florida. I don't know if you've, Kansas, is that where they are? Who are at the most extreme. I would hate it if they judged Anabaptists on the basis of Munster. Let's put it that way, and said, oh, well, we know who you are. You're Munsterites. That's absolutely wrong. On the other hand, we do need to name and recognize circumstances in the world where it is very difficult, where Christians and Muslims have found it very difficult to live next to each other. And that's a reality. On the other hand, we also can tell amazing stories of examples where Christians, and here I'm talking about Mennonites, groups in Mennonite World Conference, have found partners in Muslim communities to collaborate in remarkable gestures of service and outreach. One of the most powerful examples is in Indonesia, when after the typhoon or the tidal wave, the tsunami in Aceh, devastated. I mean, it was a horrific human destruction. And a small group of Indonesian Mennonites from the GKMI church and a somewhat radicalized Muslim group called themselves Hezbollah, but different than the Hezbollah in the Middle East, collaborated in reaching out to victims of that tsunami and have built relationships. It doesn't mean they agree with each other. It doesn't mean that they have resolved or said our differences don't matter, but they have found ways to work together. And that's not just in Indonesia. In Kenya, in Uganda, there have been significant conversations. In Winnipeg, there have been significant conversations that Harry Huebner and some others have initiated and moved forward. And that's, I see that as also part of the future of our church. Differences in ethical practices, these aren't going to go away for us. But our global church, we have significant differences in how we think about some basic ways of being in the world. And our groups are sometimes in a process of shifting. So when we say never acceptable on divorce, I think it's very interesting. In North America and Europe, the numbers are here. Africa, Asia, Latin America looks quite different. And you know, these numbers, I wouldn't get too hung up on the exact number, but it suggests sort of divergences that are worth being attentive to. Differences in understanding of the Holy Spirit. Again, it's not surprising, but churches in Asia, Africa, and Latin America tend to be much more comfortable with the language of the Holy Spirit in dramatic ways, including deliverance from demons, confidence in the reality of prophetic visions, of healings, of naming evil, not just as a structural reality, but as a demonic presence, and resisting it with access or understanding of the living reality of the Holy Spirit. We've had people who responded to the survey who said they had either witnessed people being raised from the dead, or at least one case, that person himself had been raised from the dead. So these are, I wouldn't say everyday occurrences, but these are not surprising phenomenon in our among our global brothers and sisters. And okay, I think in the future that's going to be part of our, if we care about the global church, that will be a part of it. And I need to wind this up. Let me maybe conclude with this. And saying behind all of this, I think a huge challenge we face, and it's not just in the global church. This is a challenge we face in our own communities. Frankly, it's a challenge I face in my own head between what might be called traditional worldviews, such as the one I just described, in which people are very comfortable with the sense that spirits inhabit material objects, and that the line between the spirit world and the material world is very thin, and assume that if bad things happen, there is a reason for it. That's not just to be explained meteorologically or with a scientific explanation. And if good things happen, well, there's a reason for that too. A modern worldview that emerged in the course of the late 19th and 20th century in Western Christianity, but is a historical phenomenon that places a great deal of emphasis on doctrine, on rational, what you believe, on formulating belief in very carefully framed language, and of thinking about faith in terms of propositional truths that you can check off or not. But the positive, of course, is seeking clarity, a clarity in terms of belief and practice. And then postmodern. We have in Mennonite World Fellowship, we have groups who are perfectly comfortable with diversity and say, yes, of course the Spirit's going to move differently in one culture than it does in another. I don't know if that's a definition of postmodern, but it is an orientation that says diversity is a gift of the Spirit, not a threat to us. And that God is present in ways that we have not yet begun to imagine. And that we don't have to name every place that God is present. We can just trust that God is there, that God was there before we showed up. And that's okay. All three, and these are too simple, but all three of these are part of Mennonite World, they're part of our global fellowship. And I suspect they're part of our communities. And as I said, I feel them. I mean, I can identify with some aspects of all of these as well. And I guess part of the question is, what will it mean for us in the future to be rubbing shoulders, to be working alongside each other, to look at our neighbor in the pew, and we realize that you are a little bit more oriented somewhere on a spectrum here than I am, or you combine these in a way that looks different than the way I combine. If this seems to me to be a summary of perhaps the most important challenge that we face in our congregations, in our conferences, and in our global fellowship. And nope, I'm not going to go there. I would just say, let me stop there and leave us again with this challenge for the future. How will we nurture a sense of shared identity? In this room, there's a beautiful range of variety, yet we all found ourselves here. What's the nature of that unity? Can we name, it's not the same as a congregation, but it's something. What's the nature of the unity that we seek, and how might we nurture it in the future? I was going to close with something else, but I've taken too much time already, so I'll stop there and invite your reflections, your reactions to this. Some of you have heard me say these things before, and I apologize, but maybe new ideas have come to you in the meantime. Thanks for your patience, and I invite your comments. Can I go without a mic? Yeah. You can hear me okay. And I'd invite you, I don't think we have handheld mics, so I invite you to just stand up and speak louder. You don't have to stand up. Just speak loudly, maybe say your name before you share your perspective.